It goes back to respecting the differences of other people. Just because you don't like the way someone looks, it doesn't mean they're a threat, or doesn't mean they deserve to die.
Preach, man.
I mean, that's George Floyd, that's what that was at the end of the day, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, who puts their knee on someone's neck? You know what I'm saying? Like, who does that? There's just so much of that hate and racism that is instilled in our culture. Why could we walk down the street? They don't know nothing about me and hate me just because of the way I look. Definitely have experienced racism in my life and, you know, take those opportunities for teaching moments. I don't look at people who, you know, white people who don't look like me. I don't think every person is racist. I don't treat people as those people have treated me. I try to see the good in everyone and treat people as I want to be treated. So that's something that, you know, I try to tell others to do too. Sometimes it can be hard and it's easy to hold things in and put maybe certain resentment or certain things, but I do try to see the good in individuals, and especially again those who don't look like me, as it's easy to kind of make one stereotype that, you know, all white people are evil or all white people are racist.
All right, everybody, welcome to episode 2. This is none other than Authentically. I'm your host, Charlie. Man, this is just a podcast aimed at keeping it real in a world full of facades and fakes and just trying to, spark conversation, talking about stuff that actually matters in a world where you're scrolling and seeing a lot of opinions and, everybody just on filters. We just try to keep it real, keep it authentic. And I don't know who better to ask for this episode 2 than my groomsmen, one of my brothers, my dude. I work with this dude at the Detroit Pistons, and he went to Central Michigan University. He's got a master's degree, Fire Up Chips. He works for Global Communications at General Motors right now. He has such a polished, experienced resume, and especially with what's going on in the world today, man. This guy, he serves his family, he serves his community, he serves his church, he can sing. He can. They've got like buildings at Central Michigan that are going to be named after him. He's growing a beard in quarantine. I mean, this guy is not only making an impact in Michigan and you know, jet setting across the country, across the world, in community relations, working for an NBA team in the Pistons, all the way to Fortune 500 companies, including General Motors and the Global Communications Diversity Department, promoting diversity, awareness, and inclusion. I love you, my brother. My brother, Lester Booker Jr., LBJ. Everybody, give it up for the one and only LBJ. Thank you for joining me today, man.
Absolutely, Charlie. Thank you so much for inviting me to participate. I'm honored to be the second guest of your newly created podcast. So I'm looking forward to some great dialogue today.
Yes, sir. So first of all, LBJ, how are you doing today, man?
I'm good, man. It's Saturday. It's been a long week. So I'm happy to just kind of take a minute and just relax, have some good dialogue with you. But yeah, I'm just looking forward to just relaxing this weekend, catching up with people, catching up on sleep, and just resting and chilling. So.
And, you know, first of all, I just want to say, man, it's kind of crazy in this podcast format because we just have conversations on the regular, man, just
sure,
keeping it real, just being ourselves. And I think that's rare to find, especially today. So I just want to, first of all, give you a huge shout out. And I just want to publicly acknowledge that you are, you've been with me through some of the hardest days of my life. I remember we had these talks at LA Fitness, like, let's go just talk, man. So we were chopping it up and just relaxing there and just having some conversations, going through some of the hardest days of my life. You were there for me, and to have a true friend like that, to see the struggle and to see the desert season all the way to my oasis, getting married to my wonderful bride, like, you have been there through it all. So I just want to publicly acknowledge that and give you a huge shout out and appreciate you, because you're a true friend, you're a true brother, and that's rare to find. So I appreciate you, my brother.
No problem. I love you, man. I'm proud to have been a part of your life. I think 2011, I think it was. So again, almost a decade, and again, seeing you grow personally and professionally, and you know, iron sharpening iron, has been a blessing. So very, very proud of you, and all the way out in Phoenix, But we make sure that we make time to chop it up if it's not phone. But when I am there or when you're back in Detroit, you know, we try to make sure we do see each other. So, yeah.
Yes. It's like we picked up where we left off every time.
Exactly. Exactly.
So, yeah, just I know that you said it's been a crazy week.
Yeah. Like,
how have you been with this whole quarantine over the past few months? Has it put things into perspective for you? Because, like, it was quarantine, and then this whole movement started happening with Black Lives Matter. I know that was trending a few years ago, and all of a sudden it jumped back up. I know we were talking about this, that just because it's trending now, like, and you mentioned, you know, that it being a buzzword, like, this dialogue should have been happening this whole time. Like, why all of a sudden people are starting to wake up? And that might obviously is a good thing because it's spreading awareness. But yeah, just how have you been in quarantine and then just seeing all of this transpire within the past few weeks?
Sure. So quarantine, definitely. I mean, this has been, you know, I think 2020 itself has been one of the most interesting years I think any of us have been alive. You know, I think, you know, starting back, you know, coming into a new decade, I think a lot of people were excited, you know, a fresh start, you know, turning the chapter, you know, next season in my life. And then, you know, January comes, you know, we have Kobe's death, which is unexpected. So I know that impacted a lot of people. You know, he was a great role model and, you know, definitely just like, wow, like that kind of legacy and that kind of, life is gone, you know, that quick. And then, you know, coming into February, and for me personally, I had a lot of travel in February. So I was pretty much, you know, on the go for most of the month. And then coming into March, and literally breaks stopped. And again, this virus, you know, spreading globally across the world, and really, like, literally God stopping the planet is stopped. you know, it's been been challenging, but it's been good reflection time. Definitely this COVID virus has hit the African American community really, really hard, people of color. So again, I think some of the data says, like, you know, 40% of the deaths are people of color. And then in Michigan specifically, 14% of the population in Michigan is African American. So just looking at those numbers and looking at the you know, disparities with healthcare opportunities, things like that, is a challenge. Personally, you know, I have some relatives that have been affected by COVID-19 through in the community. I know some people community-wise and church-wise who have passed on. So again, it's been very, very tough and challenging to kind of watch the spread of this virus and, you know, the impact it's had on people's families and loved ones and all of that. But on the flip side, again, I'm taking the time to really reset and, know who you are, kind of get back to some of the basics. I think that's part of what some of this journey has been for everyone in terms of communicating with people who you don't communicate with too often, setting, you know, doing things that you normally don't do. I've been doing a lot of journaling during this time, writing positive affirmations, because it's easy, you know, to get anxious and have anxiety and depression and worry and fear during this time. But definitely trusting God to get us to the next chapter and, you know, what is going to be on the flip side of COVID-19. So that's one of the things I've tried to focus on. What is, you know, that look like for my life? What does that look like for the people's lives that are attached to me? How are we going to be better after this? This is a quote directly from a friend of mine, and I kind of edited it a little bit. If you haven't changed at all during this quarantine, something's wrong with you. There's something that can be changed in yourself when you look in the mirror. It's something that you can, if it's a business you want to start, if it's a podcast like you're doing, if it's a journal you want to write, if it's whatever it is, a blog, whatever it is, it's something that can be done that you kind of put on the back burner and haven't done. That, you know, God is leading you to do, or as a personal goal of yourself. So I think that's part of this quarantine. And then even, you know, COVID's still going on. I know people, you know, with all the things going on with Black Lives Matters and the racial injustice, people have kind of, you know, forgot about COVID and kind of put it on the back seat. You know, the virus is still out there. 21 states are still spiking. So again, wear your mask. I'll give a plug here. Wear your mask, you know, hand sanitizer, social distancing, you know, do the things that you're supposed to be doing. So again, in the fourth quarter, we really can kind of get back to business as usual. From a, you know, racial perspective, definitely hit me hard with everything going on with these deaths of these African Americans that, again, they're, you know, good human beings and living their lives. And, and all of that. So definitely hard to see that. And it's kind of one of those things. It's like 50 years ago, we were kind of in the same spot. So really, what has happened? What steps have been taken? Action steps. There's a lot of conversations, a lot of talking that happens, but what are the action steps we're taking to make our society better, make ourselves as individuals better, educating ourselves, treating people with respect and dignity? You might not agree with them, but treating them with respect, respecting them as a human being. You know, those are all basic principles that we all should be guided by. So it's been challenging to watch. You know, again, I think the community is coming together through some of this, through the, you know, the virus, as well as through the protests. You see people of different skin colors. You know, when all this stuff hit, I got a lot of emails and text messages just from, you know, people who don't look like me that are friends that really love me and care for me and told me, you know, they love me and they appreciate the friendship and all of that. And really, you know, I got some really profound and great messages from some people. I'm like, wow, like that's some deep messaging you sent to me. So I was appreciative for that. But it definitely, you know, this year has been a challenge altogether. And I think going back, and I'll let you talk after this, I'm sorry to run my mouth so much, but I think it's put in perspective how ungrateful we were as a people. And, you know, the basics of getting a haircut, you know, I haven't had a haircut since March. You know, it's the basics of going to church. I haven't went to church since March. You know, how we even go to the grocery store, traveling, things like that. I'm used to getting on planes a few times a month, as Charlie knows. And, you know, I haven't traveled since February. So it's a very humbling experience. And again, those are things that I know definitely I'm going to always be more grateful for, those opportunities.
Wow. I mean, and then especially in Michigan as well, I know you touched on this with Michigan being one of the hardest hit states, and this affected you personally, right? Because it one of your family members was going through it. And how was that time for you?
Yeah, I actually, and again, we have two now. We have another family member that tested positive, so she's at the end of her quarantine time. Mm-hmm. She was in a nursing home facility. But yeah, I have another family member that again is still fighting. He's doing much better. I talked to my father today about it, and he's, you know, doing much better. But was on a ventilator, was in the hospital for about 35 days, 40 days. So again, this virus is no joke. You know, healthy person again, a little bit older. So again, I know it's attacking people who have lower immune systems and older and who have underlying issues. But definitely, a big shock for me. So again, telling everybody just be safe. You don't got to go out, stay home, condense your trips, order on Amazon, order on, you know, online, you know, so you don't have to go out as much. But if you do, wear your mask, be respectful.
And you mentioned as well, just being grateful and, you know, keeping things in perspective, especially, you know, I think we did honestly take a lot of this for granted, the travel, going to a sporting event, you know, sports being canceled throughout the world. And realizing something even simple as that, like as it's such a part of our culture and our society, that these different events, different ways of how we go about living have just all of a sudden they've been on pause the past few months. And, you know, I was listening to Bishop T.D. Jakes and what he was having to say, and Pastor John Gray. And there was just, I think, a little bit of this internal just outrage, because, you know, you got quarantine and then you've got, you know, this racial unrest from what's been, it seems like, systemic. And I'm going to talk for me personally, because I think there's also, there's a virus plaguing us from this pandemic, and there's also been a spiritual virus pandemic that has affected the root of, I think, our country. And especially out in Michigan, just when it comes to race as well, and how we perceive each other. Like for me growing up in Michigan, I'd love to hear how it was for you growing up as well, and going to Central, which we know is, you know, out in the country. It's in Mount Pleasant. I remember doing a lot of stories out there and being one of the only people that looked like me. But the thing is, Lester, I never realized that I looked any different, because I grew up, you know, my grandparents were in Detroit, and then, you know, moved to the suburbs. And so I grew up where it was predominantly white. And so I consider myself like anybody else, you know, being half Filipino and half white. Yet when I was in preschool, this kid was like, man, why are you coloring? We had to do like this full portrait. And this kid was like, why are you coloring in peach? You know, you should be coloring in orange. And that was like, okay, I look a little bit different. And then, you know, growing up, going to high school and then to college, like I started to realize that, you know, being involved with so many different activities and sports, you know, it really helped me because it helped diversify my mind and respecting all different cultures and traveling the world and loving different cultures, but realizing that not everybody thinks like that, that I could be just walking and they'll be like, oh, here's this Asian dude, man. Oh, this, he looks kind of Mexican, or he looks kind of like mixed. Like, who is this guy? And they already have a preconceived notion. And I experienced, I experienced racism because I like to, you know, think the good about everybody, but I really did, especially my freshman year of college, going to Grand Rapids for school and having a group of friends that actually didn't have my back then. And then I remember meeting you, I think it was after that summer, and I was kicked out of my house that summer. This is a whole nother situation, from a stepdad who was emotionally abusive. So I experienced racism being half Filipino in a school that was actually, hey, on top of this, LB, this was a Christian college, okay? And they had this, I went to that situation where I got literally punched in the face and they had the guy's back because I've always, you know, I was raised to handle things man to man. We had a situation where, you know, there was a conflict and I tried to work it out, talk through it. I went back to his dorm room. He punched me in the face. They went through a whole Christian college, you know, trial, and the conclusion was, you know, we'll separate them in the dorms, and you know, there wasn't any like punishment on his end. And I realized after that his dad was one of the head of the Grand Rapids police force, and also gave a lot of money to that college. And so I was in a situation where I was coming from the east side of Michigan, you know, and you know, not really made of money. And then also there was that racial undertone as well, if we're being honest. So I remember the police, they actually told me like, do you want to file charges? But you probably shouldn't, because it'll be just written off as like a bar fight. When we were in a dorm, and looking back, I was dazed. I should have filed charges. But anyways, all that being said, I mean, that's just one example. And I'll share this one briefly as well. We were driving from, this was also my freshman year of college. It was me, two black guys and two white guys, and we were driving down, and they pulled us over, and they only frisked the me and the two black guys, not the two white guys, and it was in Georgia. Okay, so I've definitely experienced some of that. I love to hear from you and how your experience has been in Michigan and leading up to today, especially being a young professional as minorities, you know, because we are minorities in this country,
right?
As brown-skinned males.
Yeah, no, absolutely, no. So for me, I'll just take it back even a little further, kind of like you did. You know, I experienced my culture shock in the seventh grade. I grew up on the east side of Detroit, native Detroiter. My parents decided we were going to move to the suburbs. I hated it the first year. I was just like, what is this? Who am I? I look around and see many people look like me. I remember being in my math class, seventh grade. I was moved in the middle of the semester too, so that didn't help matters either. And I remember looking in the class and there was nobody that looked like me in the class. And I said, what in the world? There were two other minorities. There was one Asian young man and one Indian young woman that sat behind me. And I just was like, what in the world is this? So I remember when I moved, I remember going back and seeing friends and different things. And I remember some of the comments of, you know, you sound white now, you're an Oreo now, you know, some of those things, which again, were hurtful at that time. Of course, again, I had been gone, you know, maybe a couple months, and I'm like, what are you talking about? So, you know, I had that. So again, I was exposed to people who didn't look like me at a young age. My parents have, you know, were successful in both in their jobs, and they, you know, sent me out. I went to different camps and different things. So I saw people. I was cultured, and I was fortunate to be cultured at the end of the day. So when I did go to Mount Pleasant CMU for Mount Pleasant, it wasn't as eye-opening as it was for some people, because I had been in that community. At the end of the day, they're a community predominantly white, but still a diverse community. So at CMU, you know, there were African-Americans, Hispanics, Asians, you know, Middle Eastern individuals. So there was culture there, but it's still, at the end of the day, I knew that I would be treated differently because of the color of my skin. I knew that I always had to work harder than others because of the color of my skin. So those things have always been, you know, instilled in me. I'm at an early age. Same thing again, if you were to get pulled over by the police, you know, at the end of the day, putting your hands, you know, at the top, you know, in a surrender type of position. You know, so you ask the officer, hey, can I get my license out of my pocket? Can I get my registration? Don't move or do anything, because at the end of the day, you know, I'm a person of color. I'm an African-American man, I'm a black man. So I've been taught that. So again, I have been pulled over by before, and I haven't had aggressive situations. I've done those things that I know to do. And I've been, you know, thank God I haven't had any harassment or any of those kind of situations like that, but definitely have experienced racism in my life, and you know, take those opportunities for teaching moments. I don't look at people who, you know, white people who don't look like me. I don't think every person is racist. I don't treat people as those people have treated me. I try to see the good in everyone, and treat people as I want to be treated. So that's something that, you know, I try to tell others to do too. Sometimes it can be hard, and it's easy to hold things in and put maybe certain resentment or certain things, but I do try to see the good in individuals, and especially again those who don't look like me, as it's easy to kind of make one stereotype that, you know, all white people are evil or all white people are racist.
Yeah, that's so good, man. And especially as believers, as followers of Christ, that's our calling.
Absolutely.
To love our neighbors as ourselves. Come on, man. Yep. And that's so simple, but you know, people overcomplicate that. And, you know, just, it's crazy because, yeah, I mean, look, it's amazing, all these different cultures. And, you know, when we travel, like, just wanting to go to where the locals go and not necessarily what's considered touristy. And it's just so beautiful. And like in 2012, when I went on that mission trip with Fellowship of Christian Athletes to Europe and bringing like a soccer ball to different parts of the world. And that's a universal language, sports, and being able to appreciate their cultures. And being half white myself, I know I grew up thinking like, you know, I heard of like diversity clubs, and I didn't realize until that freshman year of college that like the importance of that to celebrate your culture. Because I didn't grow up around a lot of Filipinos, I remember joining the Filipino basketball team and embracing that Filipino side and loving who I was, you know, as a mixed individual, as a man.
Yeah.
And one thing, if you want to touch on this as well, like I was also asked a lot, like what are you? And that was annoying to me because I'm like, what are you? Like I'm a man, you know?
Right.
And so I, you know, not just like, I think that obviously they were implying what my ethnicity or my background is. And so,
sure.
I mean, where do you think like the root of all this comes from, and where do you think the solution could be in what you've experienced?
Well, I'll start off saying this. I think, and again, you know, part of my role at GM, I work with multicultural diversity. I work in terms of a reputation, and just as a data point, 2044, the Census Bureau is estimating there's going to be more multicultural consumers than general market consumers. So the minority right now is going to be the majority. So at the end of the day, you're looking around and you're seeing that people are multicultural. There's interracial dating, there's cross, you know, racial dating, there's, you know, same sex marriages, things, there's all those kind of things. So at the end of the day, the world is different than what it was 50 years ago, and it's going to continue to evolve, is my point. Mm-hmm. So I think when people look around, it's not going to be the same. You might not see what you're used to seeing back in the day. So I think that's going to make people have these conversations. Again, this stuff going on right now, this stuff has been going on for 50 plus years until the action steps behind it. And I was telling somebody else this, we've had dialogue for all this time about some of these issues. Until the action goes behind it, nothing will change.
Yes.
Nothing will change until the action. We can have dialogue to a blue in the face. We can have this conversation again in 50 years at the end of the day. And this action happens, you know, on individual level, on the state, local government level, on the federal level, nothing's going to change. So I think that, again, people have to understand that the world, it's a diverse world. And they have to understand that they're going to be people that don't look like them. And it might cause, uncomfort, not to be comfortable, I should say. But I think when you're not comfortable, that's when some of the best conversations take place. And that's when you can learn, you can empathize with someone, and just have a better understanding. You might not agree, but you can have a better understanding.
Right. And I think this is more also so important in the church as well today, because when you look at churches, they're some of the most segregated places. I mean, how pivotal
exactly.
role could our church play in making a change? Because this is deeper than, I think, just legislation. I think this is a spiritual issue is
absolutely
at the core of it all.
Absolutely. And I mean, I think the other thing too, I mean, you look at church today, there's a church on every corner. I personally don't think God intended it to be that way. I think God wants us cross-culturally to worship him together in the spirit and in truth.
Yes.
But there's been so much conflict and so much pride in the church. And that's why you have churches that have broken up, churches that close. This person goes here, this person goes here, this person does this. So at the end of the day, it's one body, the church. And again, the interesting part is, if you take a step back right now, the physical church building, we can't go in right now. So the church are the people. We can't go in a building right now. We can Zoom, we can go on Facebook Live, Instagram Live, whatever you want to go, but we can't physically go in those buildings right now. And there's so much emphasis on the building. Building has to be bigger and bigger and bigger, and and get more people in, but you have to build disciples at the end of the day, but people, because right now I can't go into church, but I have to spiritually survive right now.
Yeah.
You have to spiritually survive right now. So again, it's the building of the disciples. So it's the church really is a revolving door. It's a hospital. You come in, we get fixed. We all have issues. We get fixed. We roll out so we can have impact on somebody else. We roll out so we can have impact in our community. We roll out so we can have impact in our jobs. Come back in. Oh, shoulder, I'm burdened today. Tired. Come in heavy, late, and I'm tired. I come into church. I get what I need. I get my spiritual food, and I'm out the door. So I hope that, you know, pastors and bishops and, you know, all over understand the importance of building disciples and the importance of the work that's done outside the four walls of the church. Because right now, like I said, there is no church building right now. Church is closed, but there's still ministry going on. There's still more people praying now than they've ever prayed before in their life. People are believing, people are having transparent conversations with people to have an understanding of who God is and what he is. And should I believe in him? And even though everything horrible is going on in the world right now, should I trust him? Should I put my faith in him? You know, all those conversations are going on right now. And again, it's a great opportunity for us as believers to minister to people and let our let our fruit show, you know, that even in trying times, we're still putting our faith in God.
Amen, man. Like, it's more than a building. It's what's crazy is I think a lot of our churches have been focusing more on programs than when people are dealing with problems. Mm-hmm. And the purpose of that is to be there in pain. So for others that are like, that's what Jesus did. He came to basically uproot what was all religious, the religious Pharisees at the time, what they were going through. And, you know, what if our church and Christians set the standard and set the example, because there's history of, you know, people in church having slaves, and there's people, mm-hmm. and there, that within itself is a whole another conversation as well, because
right.
You know, this is deep seated, and people can turn a blind eye to what's actually going on. Like, if people are suffering and people are going through pain, as Christians, we should be there for them. And I know mm-hmm. that I've experienced a lot of hurt from different churches, through friend groups or through mm-hmm. just being judged. And, you know, as my Christian brothers and my Christian, you know, wife have, I've learned to keep my circle small, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And, you know, not, and seeing how people are, and people are broken everywhere. I hope that we get to a place where we literally love others as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, that it doesn't matter who you are or what background you are or what culture you are. Like, we embrace you and we're going to walk with you, as opposed to just setting up all these different types of programs, which within itself, they're good, but to go beyond that and to walk alongside each other, you know?
Absolutely. I agree 1,000%. It's love right now. It's that simple.
Yes.
At the end of the day. It's just that simple. Love, yes. Perfect love conquers it all.
Yes. Love casts out fear. And you know, darkness cannot drive out darkness, as Dr. King said. Only light can do that.
Mm-hmm.
And if we bring that light, Jesus, into this equation, that's the true solution. Mm-hmm. That will solve any policy issue, any racial mm-hmm. issue. Because Jesus, he's the true bridge builder.
Right.
At the end of the day.
No, you're right.
Yeah.
Right. And I want to say this too. I think the other thing too, I've seen over my life, you know, hurt people. At the end of the day, broken people hurt people. And, you know, instead of, again, taking the time and, you know, fixing your brokenness, you throw that and cast it on someone else. So that's what, again, and that's the church people. So I think, you know, it's one of those things, you know, we all have to take, and again, quarantine is the perfect time. We all have to examine ourselves. And really take inventory, and I hope people have. I have take true inventory of yourself, and you know, your actions and your thoughts, and all of that, and is what you're doing in line with Christ? If you're believing in Christ, mm-hmm. I hope that, you know, God does visit people during this time who are not believing, and I pray that people really you know, just take inventory of their lives and really reflect. In the good, and there's so much good still going on in the world. You have people coming together, even, you know, people helping community members, helping seniors right now that can't go outside, making masks and donating masks and donating dollars to organizations. All that stuff's great. In spite of all of our current circumstances. So there's good happening. So I think we just have to build on that good, and really just take it to the next level. But like I said, for me, I'm really trying to focus on what does life look like post when COVID kind of, the door kind of changes, you know,
right.
What does that look like? What is that new norm going to look like? Was it God doing this to erase what we thought our normal should be? You know, I caught myself saying, oh, I miss my normal. Is my normal what he wanted? Is my normal what was best for me, or what is best for me? Am I growing in my normal? Mm-hmm. Or has time, and again, he's the author of time. So just because we've been quarantined for 90 days, he's the author of time, and we can get that time back. You know, if it's his will, we can get that back. So I'm, like I said, I'm just trying to be positive and think, focus on these things, you know, scripture, you know, focus on these things, whatever's true, whatever's lovely, you know, it's hard to do that during this time when you're seeing, okay, 10 more cases, 100 more cases, 20 more states are spiking. It's hard to do that still, but gotta make your mind up that you're going to see the positive in a negative situation. So that's what helps me get through the days. Because sometimes my mind, the way my mind goes, and we've had conversations about it, I'm just like, okay, yes. I'm over here. But then I'm like, what about this over here? So it's time to just pause right now and get quiet. Really get some clarity on some things from God.
Yes.
Get some clarity on some things from your relationships with your friends and your people. Like you said, who's in your circles? Everyone in your circle, should they be in your circle? Are you taking inventory? Are those relationships, helping you grow?
Yes. Got to get the weeds out if you want a full blown garden.
Absolutely.
Man, that's so true about like who defines what normal is, because normal could be, that word I think is just a comfortable word for what we're used to. But I think God uses us the most when we're expanded outside of our comfort zones. And so I'm excited to see what this will look like, as you mentioned, after quarantine. And I just want to encourage you with these mental battles that, we are facing, it just seems all the time, like as men and as men who want to follow Christ, I think there's a real attack on manhood, especially men of integrity who want to do the right thing all day, every day. And I feel like our society has almost placed that on the back burner. And, I just want to encourage you as my brother that, to keep fighting the good fight, keep running the race God has for you, because he has amazing things in store for you and plan for you. And I think the enemy or the world or negative influence would want you or me to think otherwise about the talents and gifts he's given us and to keep those in internal. I know for me, like that's something that I've been struggling with is, fully embracing who God designed me to be and being confident in that with humility and to just be bold, like just to embrace all of these talents and to be confident in that and not shrink back on that. And so I want to encourage you to never get down, bro. Like when we do get down, like just be encouraged that his light and his way and his, what he views about you as his child is amazing. Like you are an amazing dude, and don't ever like be discouraged about the gifts that God has given you, because you have such a purpose. And there's a real attack on manhood, and I just want to encourage you as my brother in Christ, man, that we can fight this good fight together. That we are
absolutely,
when we get knocked down, let's get right back up, and let's set that standard and raise the bar for our generation and generations to come. That
absolutely.
That, as people of cult, I never like to use the word minority, but like that's who, like we're minorities in this country as minority men, brown, like different types of brown skin males, that we can run this race and set the standard, man, and to be great husbands. I know for you, an eventual great husband, a great man, and where your God has called you to be, and great brothers, great sons. Let's just do this, man.
Absolutely. No, I appreciate that, man. Like I said, it's iron sharpens iron. You know what I'm saying? That's why you have to have brothers like yourself. I have to have brothers like yourself that surround me and encourage me. Like I said, sometimes the batteries run low, at the end of the day. So you need that constant encouragement at the end of the day. And it's easy to get discouraged on this race. On your walk with God, it's easy to hurt sometime in your career, in your personal life, if things don't go as you want them to go. But, at the end of the day, everything isn't going to go like how you want to. And it doesn't mean it's not like what God wants. So that's the faith and the trust that we have. Ask anything in his name. So, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. And you mentioned this race. It's crazy because in this race that we're on, now we're talking about race a lot. And I hope that in this race, race can be just embraced. And I hope that, I know we talked about this, but I mean, just looking at it on its face level, right? Black lives matter. Like, yeah. when you hear that, what does that spark in you?
I could take it in a couple angles. And for this example, I use individually. At the end of the day, like, my life matters. I'm a black man. My life matters, even though there are millions of black people in the United States and there's around the world. The life I live is significant, and it matters, and it makes a difference, and it impacts people. So everything I do, it matters. Everything I touch, everything I think on, it matters. Yes. The decision I make, it matters. The people around me, it matters. Our community, it matters. And if everyone comes together and has the right mindset, at the end of the day, we'll definitely progress. And I think, again, the world's issues right now are really basic, making people have hard conversations that they never want to have, but are forced to have because of what's going on in the world today. So again, everyone has to have these conversations, but definitely, you know, Black Lives Matter at the end of the day. African Americans, people of color, minorities, to your point, they matter. And again, going back to 2044, are going to be the majority.
Yes.
I keep going back to that. At the end of the day, people are not going to like it or not.
Right.
The minority, it will be the majority. It's trending that way.
Yes. And with it being trending now, I know we talked about, like, why does it take, like, a trend? I hope this isn't just, like, you know, oh, it's what's cool now. Black Lives Matter is what's cool. Like, yeah. I hope this is actually authentic change for the better for my fellow. Because when I think about what happened to George Floyd and everybody else that could happen to any of my black friends, you know?
Yeah.
And yeah. I hope that this is, do you think that this is just like a fad and just what's trending, or do you think that there can be actual change from this as companies are starting to embrace Black Lives Matter and realize that, yes, they actually do matter? I mean, that, to me, that's crazy that we even have to have this conversation, right? I mean, because it should be common sense, bro. Like, I know. Is there a part of you that just kind of like...
No, and I don't interrupt you, but it goes back to, again, these conversations have happened and happened and happened.
Right.
Now the action has to happen. So, yes, again, yes. Now you have, you know, this, and I think, again, you have a generation that is not going to be quiet, a generation that continues to fight, a generation that is going to make noise. But now, again, what's going to happen? The action steps behind it has to happen. Because, mm-hmm. again, if it doesn't, we're going to have the same conversation again in 5 years or 10 years. And God forbid, you know, keep having the same conversation over and over and over and over again.
And what are some, practical action steps you think that people can take just on a personal level? And then also maybe for a systemic level as well in our country?
I think at the end of the day, respect goes back to respect. It goes back to respecting the differences of other people. Just because, you know, I like the way someone looks, it doesn't mean they're a threat. Or doesn't mean they deserve to die.
Preach, man.
I mean, George Floyd, that's what that was at the end of the day, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, who puts their knee on someone's neck? You know what I'm saying? Like, who does that?
Right.
Like, who does that? Like, right. Again, if he's bad or whatever, I understand there's protocol, but who does that? So, again, that's hate. Mm. That's hate because he's an African-American man. That's hate. A man that had a family, and, you know, so there's, I mean, just so many things that go behind that. But again, there's just so much of that hate and racism that is instilled in our culture. Somebody could, why could we walk down the street? They don't know nothing about me and hate me just because of the way I look.
Mm. How does that make you feel?
Well, getting into it. I mean, it's sad at the end of the day. I mean, I've had examples of friends that, you know, that don't look like me, and, you know, parents think I'm nice, but they don't like the way I look, so. Color my skin, so, you know, they don't like me. Their kids love me.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, it's not a great feeling, but I mean, you know, I'm very happy to be a black man. I wouldn't change it for a thing.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, so you know, we have, again, that's where you know, to see past that for certain people, love past that, educate people, have the dialogue if people want to have it. They don't want to have it, I can't help you. I can pray for you from a distance.
Right.
I can't, you know. You know me. Every right. distance, so.
Well,
so
Lester Booker Jr., I want to celebrate you. And you are an African-American, a Black male, and I celebrate you for being Black and for being,
thank you, brother,
even beyond that, and most importantly, a follower of Christ and a man chasing after God's heart. Yeah. So I celebrate you.
Thank you, brother.
And you are loved and appreciated, man. And
thank you, man. Love you too.
What, as we celebrate you, what are some facets of your culture that you celebrate, that you enjoy?
What you mean by culture? What do you mean?
Like just being an African American. Like for me, I love my food, my Filipino food.
Oh, okay.
That my Lola.
Which way? I know which angle you were going. That's a very open statement. Yeah.
It could be anything.
I love style. Yes. I love African-American style. I love African-American food. I love soul food. Good for the soul. Mm. I love music. I love African-American Black music. I love anything, you know, Christian worship, of course. And then going down to Motown and smooth jazz. I love that as well. You know, some R&B, some hip hop. I mean, just love the different beats of the song. You know, any kind of song make your head move a little bit, going to the beat. You know, I just love, you know, certain brands I love that are heavy with African Americans. I just love certain things. Just style. I make my own style at the end of the day. And, you know, that's what I lead with. My style is suits, if I could, you know, professional, casual, whatever it may be. I love the style that brothers have. It's one of a million. I miss my haircuts, so that's something, you know, that's important to me. So I'm not gonna take this hat off because it's a little bit of a disaster under here. But we'll be getting a haircut soon. And when you go to the barbershop, come out of the barbershop, Charlie, can't nobody tell you nothing. You feel that good.
Yes.
You feel that good.
It is the post-barbershop feeling.
Listen, I don't care what anybody, you can't tell me nothing. After I get a haircut, and I'm a person, I have a haircut at the standing appointment, usually every week. So at the same time, every Thursday, 6 a.m., I get my haircut. Mm. When I'm telling you that, those few days after, when that haircut is fresh, you can't tell me nothing. I don't care what you say.
Game 7, NBA
Finals. I know I look good. Clutch. I know I look good.
That's that type of feeling.
Exactly. No, I look good. Snow, sleet, rain, shine. Like, boom.
What's your go-to haircut when you go to the barber? What do you get?
Oh, I mean, it's just you call it the LB special at the end of the day. Just, you know, haircut down, sides tapered, back tapered, fresh line, razor line, you know, beard trimmed down, you know. Trimmed,
nice.
Yeah,
it's tough to find someone who can cut my type of hair because I try to get a fade.
I know. Yeah, I saw you. So your dad do it for you. I saw you. You look good.
Yeah, my dad did. My dad can do it really well because obviously he knows the type of hair. So, hopefully, I'll just go. I'll just keep flying back to Michigan and have him hook me up.
Or you fly him there.
Right, fly him here. That's right.
Mm-hmm. So, there's got to be a barber there for you.
So. I've been going to Great Clips, save some money. Hey man, save some money. But at the end of each or towards the end of each podcast, man, there's a segment. Mm-hmm. Just to keep it fun too, keep it light. It's called "Are You For Real?" So it's like a speed round, four different questions. You ready for it?
Sure, let's go.
All right, here we go. So the segment, are you for real? First question. First question. What is your favorite fast food restaurant, hands down?
Favorite fast food restaurant, hands down, I go to Wendy's.
Really? Why Wendy's? Nuggets?
because I love the nuggets and the 4 for 4 junior bacon cheeseburger. Oh, I shouldn't be eating it. I get every blue moon. 4 for 4 junior bacon cheeseburger, chicken nuggets with barbecue sauce, ketchup, fries, and then I get like the Sprite Zero. $4.24. Don't judge me. I know the price by heart.
I do. I know that well as well. Especially when I was living that that bachelor life, you know.
Yeah.
4.24. Frosties are good.
Yeah, you I like get them every Frosties. If I have to get like a milkshake, I'll go to Arby's. I like Arby's milkshake.
Oh, the Jamocha shakes. Have you had those?
I had the mint ones. Those are good.
You gotta try the Jamocha Arby's shake.
Okay, there's a mint one, but then there's also they had it. It was special. They had an orange shake, and it was amazing.
Does it taste kind of like the orange shake?
Yeah, it tastes like an orange. It tastes like an orange sickle. Mm. Cream in it. It was whipped. It was so good.
Are those still there? I might go to Arby's today to get that.
I think it was a special. I think they were like teasing it. I'm not sure if it's still there now, but it was for a while. So I got them a couple times. But
nice. Number two. Mm-hmm. If you could play any Olympic sport, what would you play?
Wow. If I could play any sport. I would just do. I would probably say. I mean, I used to throw shot put, in track. So I would throw. I would say shot put, discus, or I would love to do like the 4x100 relay.
Nice. Number three. What is your favorite memory?
Wow. Favorite memory, graduating from grad school at CMU. That was a decade ago.
Nice. Yeah,
that was a great moment. I mean, again, you know, I got my first degree and that was even great, but I mean, getting a second degree, you know, as a black man, you know, getting through grad school, you know, working multiple jobs, you know, driving back and forth between Mount Pleasant, CMU, and then the Detroit Pistons, the Palace of Auburn Hills at the time, you know, 4-hour round trip, you know, grinding, and just to get that degree. And just, I remember, and real quick, I can tell this story real quick. I had a teacher, counselor, person tell me that, you know, I couldn't do it, you know, couldn't go to college, have to go to community college. And just, you know, I thought about that. And thought about that statement of how if I would have internalized that could have changed my trajectory. And now, again, where I am now, where I'm blessed to be right now, having 2 degrees, you know, almost 15 years of experience professionally and working for some very, very large corporations and really having impact, I'm very blessed. So you can't take every comment people make at face value.
Mm. That's awesome, man. You proved them wrong. Yeah. You proved the haters wrong.
I did.
And you know, Amber and I, we've had these conversations too. Even when you're doing something right or you're like trying to make an impact, there will always be at least one person that will hate on you for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. They'll find any type of criticism, and now it's typing behind this keyboard because it's so we're not saying it, you know, face to face.
Yeah, that's all you can do is type little notes.
Right. All right, number four.
Yes, sir.
If you had a superhero power, what would it be and why?
Wow. Superhero power. That's a hard question. I got 2 answers, but I'm only going to give one. I would want to fly. I want to fly, number one, just to get places quicker and avoid traffic and all that stuff. But number two, just to see things that I can't see because, you know, I'm in one place. Mm. But it's just to kind of see other things that are going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You had a second one too?
Yeah, but I don't want to – I think I was going to say to go back in time, kind of like Back to the Future. But I don't want to – every experience I've realized, every experience, everything we go through personally, professionally, spiritually – financially, is meant to build this up. So I want to change what's happened, because I've grown from, you know, the things that have been mistakes, or I've grown from the negative experiences or hurt or things like that. I've grown from it. So the other quote I would say for this too, when someone shows you who they are the first time, believe it. And that's Maya Angelou. So again, in life, relationships, friendships, you know, at the end of the day, sometimes things don't work out as they should, or will work out like they, like you think they are. Right. It doesn't mean that it's you per se. It's God shielding you from something.
Wow.
Protecting you from something. You know.
And that's the ultimate superhero power, God's armor at the end of the day.
The whole armor.
How have you dealt with that Maya Angelou quote? Have you experienced that in your life? And
absolutely.
How have you dealt with people when you realize their true colors, like right off the bat?
Yeah, I mean it's like I said, I've experienced a lot of different things, you know, great and not so great. I think you know, each situation has been different. But I've again tried for the most part to be integral in that. And again, when you have to pivot and when God shows you it, let it go. It might, it's because it's going to be harder if you keep it up versus letting it go in that moment.
Yes.
So at the end of the day, like if relationships or people, those things aren't healthy for you, you got to cut that stuff loose, because you have a destiny, you have a future. You don't let anybody mess with your destiny.
Let's go, man. Let's go. And
destiny.
Yes. And I think there's a difference. Like, we can be loving and we can be gracious and we can be forgiving. Yeah, we don't need toxicity to stick with us.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. You don't have time for toxic or negative people. Mm. You need people that are building you up, that are there for you. And again, you fall, the trust exercise.
Right.
You know, you fall back and they're there to hold you up. That's what you need. The encouragement, you know, have your back. Have your back when you're not there, and maybe comments are said or somebody says something, they're there for you, you know, when you're there and when you're not there.
Yes.
At the end of the day. So, you know, that's I'm blessed again. You know, I turned 35 in a couple months. I'm blessed to be at a very good spot in my life.
Yes.
When it comes to relationships, mentors, people that I know have my back.
Yes.
So I'm in a very, very good place.
That's a gift, bro.
It is. It really is. Yes. It really is. And I try to, again, give that to others. You know, make sure that, you know, I'm a good mentor to you, mentor to others, you know, the little brothers to me.
Yes. My big brother.
Because I don't want to I don't want to disappoint y'all. So it is a responsibility, you know, when you're a mentor and a big brother to people, because they're looking for you. For the right decisions and to lead. And again, you know, no one's perfect, but you know, it's pressure from that perspective. You take it seriously. It is.
Right. I know that, you know, being the oldest brother and being the oldest cousin in my family, it's something that, you know, I don't take lightly, because I know that there's people looking up to me and I have to carry that mantle. And sometimes I can be a lonely and a hard place to be as well, when you feel like, you know, sometimes you're in that battle, but you know that you got God fighting for you, and you got, you know, your ride or dies beside you. And so again, man, I just thank God for the journey. You mentioned growing through that. And I mentioned, you know, at the start of this, that there's been so many, dark seasons, from an emotional stepdad to getting kicked out of the house, to getting my heart broken when I came back from Europe, in a relationship to getting beat up physically, emotionally, spiritually at a college, a private college. And, you know, to be able to have a friend, and especially this past few weeks, bro, has been some of the darkest, like some of the hardest days of my life too, to go home to Michigan, to lose my Lola, who is my not only my grandmother, but my friend and my grandfather, who, speaking of race, he did it before it was cool. I mean, he was in community relations and plumbing, pipe fitting industry, and he dedicated his career to bringing people from the city of Detroit together to talk with the suburbs, and bringing people from all different backgrounds, political differences, together to the table to talk. And it is going to be my honor to carry on his legacy and my grandparents' legacies. And I thank God my bride could be there with me during that difficult season to lose two grandparents in the span of a week. And I thank you and my brother and my close friends that you guys, like, I remember that you called me immediately, you know, and you texted me to make sure I was good. And I just want to appreciate you for that. And thank you again publicly for that, because it is a gift. And I want to acknowledge that it's a true gift to have not only a close friend, but a brother. And so thanks for being my brother in the darkest days of my life and celebrating with me as one of my groomsmen in November 11th, 2017, man. 2017. We prayed about that, man.
We did.
Prayed that, bro. We prayed, bro.
We did.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes, sir, we did.
I love you, man.
Love you too, man. We pray many a nights about it.
Yes. And we'll be praying for your future spouse, bro, your future wife.
Amen. Amen.
He's out there, man. Don't ever settle, man. There's too many fake ones out there, bro.
You know that. We've had that conversation. Yes. I will not be settling, you know, at the end of the day. I'm not even going to get in it now, but I will not settle, so.
Yeah,
I'm good with being single until I find the right one.
Yes.
End of the day, period.
Is there any
that simple
encouragement you want to give to those who are single as well out there? Because
absolutely.
I know that it is so well. I want to encourage real quick that knowing what it was like to be in relationships where you felt like you were dragging that other person along, to be in a relationship, in a marriage now where we're thriving together because we're both individuals loving Christ. And then with him at the center, us bringing us closer together. I thank God that he answered my prayers. That's only through him. If it was up to me, I'd be in a place where I wouldn't be happy. You know, it would be miserable. Mm-hmm. And so I thank God himself waited for who God has for me. And so I want to encourage those listening to wait for the one God is planning for you. And as a single dude now, what was your encouragement be?
No, I mean, I think, you know, you hit it nail on the head. I mean, at the end of the day, I think you have to realize who you are. And again, you have to stay in God's face about marriage. And, you know, marriage is something serious. I think marriage is something that is not taken as seriously today as it should be from when, again, different generations. I think it's important to, you know, write down the things that you want in a spouse. And pray about those things. I have those things written in a journal, affirmation. And, you know, those are the things that you focus on. And again, if those things, if that person is not aligning with those things, then you need to separate yourself. Doesn't mean that, you know, that person may not get married, but that might per person isn't for you at the end of the day.
Right.
So I think you have to write down the traits of what you want in a spouse. And, you know, you have to wait at the end of the day, you know. Sometimes I think we get we get weary in well doing, and sometimes we like, okay, well, I need this, I had to have it, and then it can be the most detrimental thing to us. And again, I've had people I know that's they've, you know, shifted that way, and then that's happened. So, you know, I'm encourage people again. You know, you have to know who you are in Christ, and know who you are as an individual, and then that person, you guys should be complementing each other. You guys should be a mesh and kind of like that power and dream kind of couple. And that's where you'll see, not saying that you're going to agree on everything. We know that. You're not going to agree on every single thing. But that alignment, you know, being equally yoked, that's really important too.
Yes.
So those are some things I would just encourage you. And again, just don't get weary. You know, your days, keep praying, keep believing, keep having faith, your day will come. Again, I've stood in a lot of weddings. A lot of my friends are married. As Charlie is, and they're doing, and they're thriving, and I'm very, very happy for all of them. And I told everybody, knows when it's my time, everybody's gonna be in my wedding. But people always ask me all the time, Charlie, they're like, Lester, you've been in everybody's wedding. Like, what is it gonna look like for you? I'm probably gonna have like two rows. It's gonna be like a semicircle. It's gonna be something. It's gonna be something very different.
Yes, bro.
Yep. It's gonna be something like you guys. It's gonna be something out of this world. You're gonna be like, what? Who does that? And only Lester does that.
Nice. Well, hey, we're almost done here, man. I just got two more questions for you, bro.
Sure.
So what are the top three things you're most passionate about?
top three things I'm most passionate about. You know, Christ, of course, you know, number one, passionate about the Lord. Two, passionate about community development. I think, again, it's important that everyone has that community to be a part of, and have the resources to do what they need to do. The community, I think individuals are built in the community. So again, everyone is kind of like one of those things you can just, you're being a part of the community, and then you're going to go out and you're going to create that community somewhere else. So that's really important to me. Communities around the world, building communities, a safe environment where people can share and talk and things like that. And then I would say number three is, again, diversity and inclusion. Again, it's very important to me, near and dear to my heart. I just this year established a scholarship at Central Michigan University. It's called the Lester Booker Jr. Scholarship for Diversity and Inclusion. It's an endowment. So it's one student every year. Will receive a $2,500 scholarship at CMU. It could be a sophomore or higher, 3.0 GPA. There's some other criteria, and then you have to write a one-page essay defining how multicultural audiences are perceived by the media. So that's really something that's very, very important to me, diversity of thought, equality, treating people with respect, not just lip service, but really actions and treating people how they should be treated. So that's something that's very, very important and near and dear to my heart. So I'm excited for that scholarship to, again, see in 10 years where that is and how many individuals get that and where they go. And that's a great story to, I'm a PR professional, Charlie, we both are the same in terms of what's the story I want for that scholarship. I want the story to be like, okay, wow, these 10 individuals, look where they are and look what they're doing. And just the, small seed of $2,500 help impact their lives and take them to where they're going.
Wow. That's amazing, man. Congratulations for that. And
thank you.
God is going to use you continually. He's already been using you, and he's going to use you to help promote diversity, inclusion, as a follower of him, you know, and leave that legacy. So
yes,
keep running that race, man.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. I appreciate you too, man. And then lastly, I know when I went to Oakland, I felt honored that they awarded me with the Keeper of the Dream Scholarship, you know, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., promoting interracial understanding on campus. And so for me and you, that just comes naturally, right? Because we love people and we love different backgrounds and cultures. But for those listening, and for those who that might not come naturally, because we've realized obviously that's the case because racism still exists, or people might not realize, you know, the celebrate the differences in people. Like, what would you say to those who aren't African American, especially during this time? How could they best support the Black community?
I think just listen. That's where it starts. Sometimes, some people don't know what to say, and maybe you don't have to say anything. If you're there, and you show up, and you listen, and you're authentic, I think that makes the world of a difference versus you just feeling like you have to say something and you just give them lip service. So I think, again, it's empathy, it's being a listening ear, being an ally, again, standing up for what's right, number one. And you having, if that person, individual has a strong network or have a voice, showing that and supporting. So again, like I said, I'm very blessed that I have people who aren't the same skin color as me that are great allies and great supporters and great friends, and have my back. So again, they get it. And again, they might not know what to say every time in that moment, but they're there to listen. And that goes a long way. For me.
So listen, at the end of the day, that's what the key is. Listen. Well, it has been a pleasure to listen to you today and for you to listen to me.
Yes, sir.
Thank you again for your time and for being my guest on the second episode. And dude, just keep killing
it. My pleasure.
Man. You're the man.
Thank you so much. I hope to be a guest again. So when you get through whatever number you're going to get it through, I want to come back on again and we can do part two of this. But no, definitely, I'm very proud of you, Charlie. I'll say this publicly too, very proud of you. And, you know, we've had this conversation again. The Lord is using you, you know, through TV that people can see him and not see necessarily you, but see him in you. And I'm very proud of all that you're doing. I know your steps are ordered. I know you're going to really do some great, amazing things. Could be in Phoenix, could be somewhere else. We don't know yet, but I think it's going to be great. And I'm very, very proud of the determination and perseverance that you have.
I appreciate that, LBJ. Fire up chips.
Bye, brother. Fire up chips all day. Fire up.
Yes, sir. All right, at 5'8". Party from the Authentically Podcast. It is coming in from the master's degree in Mount Pleasant, Michigan, residing in Canton, Michigan. It's the one, it's the only, it's Lester Booker Jr. Let's go. Love you, bro.
Let's go. Love you too, man.
What's your height?
Return of the Mac. Return of the Mac?
No, your height.
My height, how tall I am?
Yes, how tall you are.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm 5'8".
All right. All right, man, so I just thought that this would be a good opportunity for us to talk, just to chop it up as
for sure.
As brothers and, you know, knowing that we have these good conversations, why not, you know, release it to the world too? So,
I'm praying for you. Come on.
I know. If you're on the Tigers, a Central Michigan Chippewa, and you're stepping up to the plate, what would your walkout song be?
Oh, wow. For now, let's use Return of the Mac.
Return of the Mac.
Mike Morrison. I'm sending it to you.
Okay. And why Return of the Mac?
It describes it all, man. There's a dope beat to it too. Send you a I'm shocked you don't know it, but freezing up a little bit too.
I'm freezing. Title.
Yeah, like you're freezing.
Can you hear me?
There you go.
Okay.